Hey, it's Sean from Tested. Continuing our look at my 16mm movie camera collection, we had looked at the 16mm Bolex and the Soviet K3 previous to this. Today we're going to be looking at the Arriflex S or ST, and it's one of my favorite cameras. This is the camera that I still rebuild and service. There's still a lot of people buying these and using them, including schools. Like, I fix cameras for CalArts still. And at NYU, when I worked there for 12 years, we had a fleet of 100 of these that I kept running in-house. So they're a really cool little camera, and let's dive in and talk a little bit about them. So if you want to get a little more idea on how exactly the motion picture cameras work and the differences between like 16, 8mm, etc., check out our first video, because I kind of went into it there, and I'm not going to repeat it on this one. This is kind of be more about this camera in particular. If you're not familiar with Arri or Arri, depending on how you want to say it, they're a German company. It's been around for decades. They are pretty much they were the gold standard in film cameras for many, many years. And this is a model that they built starting in, I believe, 1952. And they made it clean through the mid to late 80s, virtually unchanged. To give you an idea, this is my model that was probably made in the late 50s. This one is my other one from probably the mid 70s. So 20-year difference. And you can see they're not that different. There's some additional ribbing on the body here. You can see that the viewfinder setup is a little bit different, but they're virtually identical form factor. And once they got to kind of this guy in, I think, the 60s, they didn't change that much. So we're gonna take a look at the newer guy. So we'll set our 50s model over here, and we'll take a look at this. So 16mm camera, so it's using 16 millimeter wide film, as we discussed before. This is often considered the first professional 16mm camera. 16mm for a long time was kind of considered consumer or amateur camera, so like home movies, stuff like that. And this was built to professional standards with the Arri name behind it. Arri's still around. They are still making digital cameras now. You can get limited repair parts for the old stuff still, and they do service some of the particularly 35mm film cameras. But this guy's long out of production and no longer serviced by them. But despite it being the professional, it has a lot of similarities and things in common with, say, the Bolex. So it's using 16mm film. It's using the 100-foot daylight spools, which are the smaller loads that give you about a little over 2.5 minutes of footage. But they did some other features which are nice, such as you can take this saddle off on top and add a 400-foot magazine to get the more like standard 11-minute long rolls of film for 16. So that was a nice feature for this. But if you didn't want to do that, you just use the 100-foot spools, and it's a really nice, got this really nice hand grip molded out of it. If you pick this up, it's well over, it's probably like 15 pounds. And so you're like, in this day and age, it's like, oh my God, but this was considered light and portable back in the day. Similar to the Bolex, it's using a turret system. So you would have three prime lenses, a normal, wide, and telephoto that you could switch between. This is the taking lens. Something different from the Bolex is, I don't think we talked about it in the Bolex video, but the Bolex, you'd have to be careful because you would definitely have to place the telephoto lens, which stuck out a lot, opposite of the wide, or otherwise you would see the telephoto in the wide angle shot. So this has what they call a divergent turret, which means that they stick out at a little bit of an angle from each other. So in general, you won't accidentally catch one of the other lenses in the taking lens. So that was a nice thing they did. Unlike the Bolex, which was a wind-up camera, this is a battery-powered camera. So you would typically run this off of an 8-volt battery belt or 12 volts, depending on what motor that you got for it. It was still a relatively compact, portable camera that had a lot of options. So on the camera itself, it has this this adjustable motor where you can adjust how fast or slow it's going. You could go from about 2 to 50 frames per second on this. So that gave you a nice range. 24 would be the normal filming rate. This is a little bit different motor than the typical Arri motor. Usually it looked more like this guy, which is what most people would recognize from the Arri motors, but this is a little bit different 12 volt motor that they did. You can go forward and reverse with it. It has a switch. Like the Bolex, it's a wild or MOS camera, meaning it's very loud, which you'll hear in a minute, so it's not particularly good for doing dialogue. And most of the motors, including the variable speed, were not crystal controlled, meaning they weren't precise enough to get an exact film rate going through the camera to sync up with sound. Having said that, Robert Rodriguez famously shot El Mariachi on an Arri S and a tape deck. And he would just keep the camera far away from the sound as possible. And he would do really short takes because you could get the sound kind of in sync for a little bit. And the longer the scene went, the more the dialogue will go out of sync. So he would either do really short takes or you would loop it afterwards, meaning you just re-record the dialogue in the studio. But he shot his whole first feature film on an Arri S. So they are great little cameras. And they're tanks. They're very reliable. They just keep going and going and going. So it's a cast aluminum body. They typically have this cool wrinkle paint on it, kind of like an engine. And we'll take the door off here. It has this cool latching mechanism. And when you take this off, you notice the door is pretty heavy because in here, in the viewfinding system, there is a whole tube of glass elements, probably like at 6 to 8, if I recall. And you can see the front one here. So it adds a lot of weight to the door. And one of my tests whenever I'm fixing these is I will shake the door to listen to hear if I can hear any loose glass elements, because that happens a lot. And if that happens, then what you're seeing in the viewfinder will not be accurate to what you're actually recording onto the film. Another common problem with these is people drop the doors a lot and then chip them. So I would have little metal epoxy repairs on those often to fix those up. And then the inside of the camera, not completely different from the Bolex. It has the sprockets with the teeth on it to drive the film through. This guy is called the pressure roller, which is basically keeping the film pressed up against those sprockets. You can disengage it in order to load it. Then it has the spindles, which are taking up the film and feeding it. These guys have little push button release mechanisms to pop it off the spindles. And if you remember, you have to have loops in the film for it to breathe as it's moving. On the Bolex, you had an automatic loop former. This, which is pretty typical of a lot of cameras, has these little white guides inscribed in the case, which shows you where to set up the film loop. So that's always very important, and we'll talk about that. Like the Bolex, you have a pressure plate, a little door swings open, and this has both the pull-down claw and it has a registration pin, which is an addition. So what happens is the pull-down claw is working to move the frame down, then the registration pin locks it in place to take the picture. I've pulled out so you can see what it looks like. Because I do fix these, I can easily take them apart so you can see the guts. But we looked at this mechanism in depth on the Bolex video, but just a quick review, like I said, the pressure plate, your spinning mirror shutter, which is actually made of glass, which is crazy, and mirrored so that it reflects light into the viewfinding system. So that lines up with that. And then it alternates between reflecting light into the viewfinder so you can see what you're shooting, and then being open so that light goes to the film. An interesting thing to note about the Arri is the way the motor engages with the mechanism. So motor, when you slide in, it goes into this rubber coupler, and the whole camera is driven by the friction of going into this rubber coupler, which is kind of a crazy system, but it totally works. One common thing that'll happen with these, and one of the things I fix is over the years, the rubber coupler will stretch out and start to get hard, and I will have to replace those so that they grip onto the motor again. If you have one of these and it is slipping, one thing you can do is put some heat shrink on the ball mechanism, and sometimes that will get you enough friction to re-engage with the motor again. It also has the transmission here, which are these kind of composite plastic wooden gears kind of. They have like a fiber that is bound together with resin that runs the whole camera that engages with these. And these are cool. They are actually spring belts. So these are the belts that engage with the take-up pull spindles and the feed spindles to run it in forward and reverse. So they just kind of friction fit over that and pull it along, which is kind of cool. So it's relatively a simple mechanism and are pretty easy to take apart. Feet and frame counters here, and your tachometer to show you how fast you're going. So my camera has been modified to take a modern 4-pin power input, kind of like a mic cable XLR. So we're gonna hook it up there. You can actually control the speed and the power switch from inside here. So you can hear, it's pretty loud. So this is why it would be problematic to shoot sound with this guy. But let's load it up real quick and show you how it goes. So we swing open the pressure plate. All right. And the film kind of goes like this. And when you're thinking about how to load it, often people put them in backwards, which is bad. So we're gonna put it on the feed side. I'm gonna stretch out maybe a foot or so. We're going to release the pressure roller right here. And we're gonna go through the first sprockets, making sure it's on the teeth. I'm gonna rotate my motor so that the registration pin's open so that I can slide the film under. I roughly eyeball lining it up with that top film loop and close the gate or close the pressure plate. Up the other side, we will roughly match it up with our loop and close our pressure roller. And that looks pretty good. That's lined up pretty good. So usually what I'll do at this point is I'll run it off a little bit just to make sure everything's going. And I can see my bottom loop is a little too big. So I'm going to slide it up a sprocket hole or two. There you go. This is way more film than I would typically run off, but for our demo purposes today, I'm pretty more. Very important, just like the Bolex, that you get the film in the slot inside that spool and you take up a few turns of this. And before you put it in the camera, give it a little tug to make sure that the film's not spinning on here. Because if it is, that means that it's not taking up and you're gonna open the camera to spaghetti, which is bad. All right, there we go. So the cool thing about the Arri-S is you can easily run it backwards. So you can do trick shots, stuff like that. So we're going the opposite way now. You can run it both forward and reverse at different speeds, which is nice. And it has some safety features in it as well, such as this little guy, which is the buckle trip switch. And what that will do is it does two things. If the camera jams, it will trigger that buckle trip and it will stop the camera so you don't destroy your film. So if for some reason you lose your loop, it'll pull tight, hit that, or hopefully if the film starts accordioning on you, it'll hit that and stop it. It'll also tend to, when you reach the end of the roll, the end will usually flick that and make it stop as well. So you know the roll is done if you weren't watching your footage counter. All right, so. Make sure that's closed. Engage. Lock it. So if your camera's in pretty good shape, you're gonna get a good seal here, but if you wanna be extra careful, you can do black tape around the door, make sure you don't have any light leaks. You could tape the saddle if you wanted to, but at this point you're ready to go, and you can push it halfway to run it a little bit. without it actually engaging, or you can go ahead and hit it and let it just do its thing. But nice little handheld camera. You don't have to worry about crank length, so you can shoot as much as you want on a take as long as it fits in your 2.5 minutes of film and the camera, or 11 minutes if you're gonna do the magazine. And the nice thing about the Arri is it came with tons and tons of options and accessories. So you could get like periscope viewfinders that will let you get real funky angles if you needed to get this in a weird position. It had different motors that you could put in, such as a animation motor. So it's this giant thing with a counter on it that you could do frame by frame. You could hit it, hook that up to an intervalometer, which would allow you to do really nice time lapses. You could fit it with a zoom lens or just about any other lens from the Arri stable, as long as it was cleared to work with the mirror clearance that's on this particular one. The turret has a little locking mechanism on it that if you don't want it to turn by accident, you can engage. And it typically would have a nice little accordion matte box that you could put in it and use glass or gelatin filters, which are just like kind of the plastic filters for different effects or color correction. But Arri S camera, great little workhorse, one of my favorite cameras that I still fix. And I'm happy to see that people are still out there using them. If you're looking to get one of these, there's lots on eBay, and you're gonna often see them really, really good prices. The problem that I warn you of is that they'll be beautiful cosmetically, but often these have sat in somebody's basement or attic for decades unused, and all of the lube is turned to glue. It may be rusty, and so it may be pretty on the outside, but you're gonna end up having to do a lot of work to get them running. So sometimes that it's a toss-up. You might get lucky and strike gold, but sometimes it's worth going to like a camera dealer that you know that it's been serviced and is running well still. So one last thing I'd warn you about is if the camera is still using the 2-pin power, which is back here in the original hookup, and it doesn't come with the power cable, be very cautious of buying that, because those power cables are impossible to find and very expensive, which is often why we do this 4-pin XLR upgrade, which lets you use standard power cables. But other than that, these are great little cameras. You can still get 16 millimeter film, both in negative and reversal from Kodak. So not only schools sending these to me for repairs, but individuals are too. So fun little camera, nice display piece. The Arriflex STs are also pretty much the same item with a little bit different lens mount setup. One of my favorite cameras out there. So hope you enjoyed this show and tell. That wraps up our movie camera collection, and hope to see you next time with something fun.